Coming up this week in computer hardware, Yoga 900 reviewed iPad Pro, AMD's Radeon R9 380X, budget Skylake V150 motherboards, Qualcomm's new Snapdragon 820, and Samsung's Exynos 8 Octra. All that and more coming up next on Twitch.
Netcasts you love
from people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Twitch is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Twitch This Week in Computer Hardware, episode 341, recorded November 12th, 2015. The fastest smartphone CPUs ever.
This episode of This Week in Computer Hardware is brought to you by the Ring Video Doorbell. With Ring, you can see and talk to anyone at your door from anywhere in the world using your smartphone. It's like caller ID for your home. Right now, get free FedEx shipping when you go to ring.com/twitch. And by Ting.com. Ting is a mobile phone service that helps you save money by offering a fair price for the services you use. Visit twitch.ting.com to get $25 towards your first device or service and to find out how much you can save. And by Drobo, a family of safe and expandable yet simple to use storage arrays. Drobos are designed to protect your important data forever. Visit drobo.com/twit and use the code TWIT100 to save $100 off a Drobo Mini, Drobo 4-Bay, or Drobo 5N.
Welcome to Twitch This Week in Computer Hardware, Twitch's weekly show that aims to bring you the most useful, most informative, most engaging, most delightful, and yes, ladies and gentlemen, the most car enthusiastic hardware coverage on the surface of the planet. However, we cannot claim domain over the oceans or the sky. My name is Patrick Norton. Joining me is Mr. Ryan Shrout.
Hello.
Who's just, you look skull hammered by the bizarre nature of my introduction this week.
Which, yeah, a little bit, not to be. I have also like over the last 2 days developed, I guess, the cold of this, of the winter for me. Right. Hopefully it's the only one I get for this fall and winter. So I went to New York City Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, and like right kind of when I woke up Monday morning, I went, like, you know, get that feeling in your throat, saying, like, eh, crap. Right. And as the days progressed, I got a little bit worse. So now I'm addicted to Dayquil.
Daywalker.
Yeah, exactly. I haven't reached into the NyQuil bag yet, trying to avoid that. I think that's better for everybody.
Scotch is for.
Yeah, that's true. I did say that last night. Where were we at? We were eating dinner somewhere, and I said, you know, if Panera had shots of whiskey, I would take one to open up these nasal passages for sure. But I asked and they didn't, so I was disappointed, you know.
Well, you know, I
such as
really
life.
Be going straight to like the scary high proof schnapps for a cold.
Yeah,
get your Northern Europe on. It's funny, we got GPUs this week, we've got laptops, we've got the launch of the iPad Pro, which is been a treat as a media consumer to watch the incredibly random reactions to that product. But let's start out with something that's kind of interesting. Qualcomm's Snapdragon 820, new camera, wireless and processing technology, Cat 12 modem, Wi-Fi adaptive calling. And if I understand this correctly, Wi-Fi adaptive calling means the ability to manage the packets. Will it automatically on the fly shift between available Wi-Fi versus the cell network?
Yeah, it will. Okay. And what's interesting about that feature is that I think there are some phones that do that already. But their technology, as long as the carrier supports VoLTE or voice over LTE, it can do that automatically. It doesn't really have to have any specific carrier implementation. And I believe it's the only one that so far can go back and forth, right? It can use Wi-Fi, and then when the Wi-Fi strength is poor, it goes back and forth. Dependent, and it is. I know it's the first one to monitor the Wi-Fi, like signal strength, right? So, like, if you lose Wi-Fi, you would usually just lose your call. This, like, if the Wi-Fi starts to get weaker, it will switch back to LTE, which is a neat idea, right? As long as carriers allow it and phones ship with that feature. So this, like, the Snapdragon 820 is something we've been hearing about for a while. I feel like maybe they've been sending out information piecemeal, try to build up some excitement for it because of the kind of the disappointing release that the 810 had. So, I mean, it's got faster CPUs. It's got faster GPUs. It's got all these cool new features like the Wi-Fi calling. The LTE modem can go up to 600 megabits per second downstream and 150 megabits per second upstream. But obviously, like, carrier network throughput is the bottleneck on all of that. It has a solution to prevent you from holding your phone wrong in that... So when your phone has an antenna, if you wrap your hand around it, you fundamentally shift the impedance of the signal coming into the antenna. And how antennas handle it today is they kind of jack up power to the antenna in order to kind of cover all ground, right? If things are weak, they pump more power into it to figure it out. This, they now have a chip that can sit between the antenna and the digital signal processor, and actually it matches the impedance of the antenna to what's coming in through your meaty hand or, you know, sitting on a metal table or whatever it is. And thus they claim to be able to extend, not only give you better call clarity and less drop calls, but more battery life in the same situations compared to, you know, antennas without this type of technology. So they got some new audio stuff. They showed some UE4 demos to show off their graphics. What else did they have? They did wireless charging. Yeah, we've seen that type of stuff before. Something called Scene Detect, which is basically like when you point your camera at something in real time, it's supposed to be able to detect what it's looking at and thus adjust the camera settings kind of accordingly. So in that picture there, the guy is actually, he's holding it up, go up to the one above it where he's holding it at a thing of a glass of wine. And the camera in real time knows that there's no people in that, no people visible, and that it's drinks, right? And so it kind of, it can say, okay, we don't need to adjust for flesh tones necessarily because there's no people in here. There's drinks in it. So maybe it's a near shot as opposed to a far shot, adjust your depth of field accordingly. And, you know, a lot of this depends on the camera apps to support doing something with that information.
Right.
You know, but it's pretty neat capability. And then if you go down to that second picture, it can also do after you've taken the photos kind of organization, right? So where you've seen, okay, here's a picture. If you go into this demo app that they built and said, okay, here's a picture of hamburger and here's a picture of a hamburger, create this new category based on those heuristics. Now look through my entire gallery and find all the pictures I've taken of hamburgers. Now, clearly in this demonstration, they have a lot of photos of hamburgers on there, but it worked fairly well. And their claim is like, yes, this is something that other people are doing, but they're doing it offsite. They're doing it in the cloud. This is doing it locally on the phone. So you get security benefits, you get kind of, you know, offline benefits, you get maybe potential performance benefits because it's utilizing CPU, GPU, DSP on the device kind of all heterogeneously to do it. Right. Next generation of it, they claim they want to add the ability to do facial recognition for it because like right now it can detect people, but it can't recognize individual faces. So that'd be pretty cool. That's something that I know everybody wants is a better way to organize their photos. Yeah, you've seen that. We've talked about MU MIMO before. So the Snapdragon 820 supports multi-user MIMO. It just means you're going to have better experience on Wi-Fi that supports that. It supports 60 gigahertz 802.11ad, wireless charging, that type of stuff. I mean, there's a ton of cool stuff in this new chip. The question is now, what vendors and how many of them are going to implement not only the controller, like the 820 period, but how many of those features are they going to integrate? Because that's the problem that Qualcomm is in right now. Hardware has kind of been commoditized where it's pretty easy to get really good performance out of an SoC for your phone or for your tablet. Right. The key is in what are the user experience differences going from product to product. And the problem for them is they don't control that necessarily, right? They don't sell a phone. Apple, if they create a new piece of hardware that does something really cool, they also create the software that allows them to integrate that, and then they sell it to the consumer. Qualcomm doesn't have that capability. They have to depend on HTC or Samsung or somebody, you know, to use their chip, integrate it correctly, have the software correctly integrated, and then promote that feature when selling their product. So it's an interesting place that they're in to really find a way to make that happen. But I think it's pretty impressive tech. And it looks like it should be a more successful product than the A10, if nothing else, for sure.
Yeah, the A10
cool one here, the low light video demo as well. Go ahead.
I was going to say the A10 was never really adopted as widely as we expected it to be, or I expected it to be.
No, not at all.
You know, it kind of seems to be an interim half step. Maybe everybody was waiting for the 820. Bigger, better, faster phones.
Yeah, I was going to say the 810 had like overheating problems that they denied, but were pretty clearly there. They were very upfront about it at this meeting. Like, hey, the 820 does not have any of those issues because this is not an off-the-shelf ARM core architecture anymore. This is their own custom CPU architecture. So it's a quad core design. You know, they're adamant about, hey, you know, the benefits of 8-core aren't really there. Ours is quad core, but it's the best performing quad core. And I don't think they should have to make that argument for people that actually pay attention, because the iPhone 6s is a dual core part, and it's probably one of the best user experiences in a phone that you can get. So they've got an uphill battle in many ways, as I was kind of describing before. But Qualcomm's been doing this for a long time, so I think if anybody can figure it out, they're probably at the top of that list.
Speaking of people who can figure it out, Samsung just announced the Exynos. Oh, I can't say that word. 8-octa 8890 application processor. Seems like a very distinct marketing kind of moment there. So literally like the day after Qualcomm announces the 820 system on a chip, Samsung drops the announcement of their Octa 8890. Sebastian wrote it up on PCPro.com. 14-nanometer FinFET process, basically like this, the Exynos 7 Octa 7420 in the Big Little configuration. Processing cores are actually custom designed this round. It's 8890 is doing ARM Cortex A53, and quote, "The big cores feature Samsung's first custom-designed CPU based on 64-bit ARM V8 architecture."
Very interesting.
Then we get the serious marketing speak. "With Samsung's own SCI, Samsung Coherent Interconnect Technology, which provides cache coherency between big and small cores, the Exynos 8 Octa fully utilizes benefits of big little structure for efficient usage of the 8 cores. Additionally, Exynos 8 Octa is built on a highly praised 14-nanometer FinFET process. These all efforts for Exynos 8 Octa provide 30% more superb performance and 10% more power efficiency," which is a little, not quite a Google translation, but has the feel of it. But essentially, they're saying it consumes less power, it's 30% better in performance, and apparently it's going to deliver the kind of efficiency with the big little design that they were hoping to get with the 7420. Integrated modem, again, category 12-13 LTE. Video processing is handled by a Mali-T 880 GPU, up from the Mali-T 60 and the 7 Octa, which is basically the biggest and baddest GPU that Mali makes. And it's going to hit production, mass production later this year. And I suspect we will see a Samsung Galaxy phone at CES that will be powered by it. I could be wrong, but I'm willing to make small wagers that we will see this name in the big 2.5-hour marathon, Samsung dishwashers to cell phones. I actually have started to really look forward to the Samsung presentation, because it's just like, you know, here's the thing we sell the most of, and here are three incredibly famous chefs to tell us why you need your dishwasher to drop water in the corners. It's just awesome. But I think it's really interesting. And of course, Samsung's still making parts for Apple. So it's a busy time at the Samsung fabs right now.
Gotcha.
It's going to be interesting. As I explode over here, you got hands on, you actually have in for testing the Lenovo Yoga 900, which is the Skylake Power 2-in-1.
I do.
Are you still there?
Yeah, no, I'm here.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I was reaching for the laptop and I had to stretch away from the microphone. I apologize.
Okay. No. There was a moment there and I was like, is he okay? Oh, my God.
It's the moment on a Skype call when you wonder if you've been talking to yourself for the last 8 minutes or so. I know that often.
It's a beautiful feeling. Well, the Lenovo Yoga 900, a beautiful laptop, that crazy watch band hinge.
Yeah.
And then the text of the keyboard is fantastic. I really like the keyboard.
You do? So you've used it as well?
Yeah, they did a press event in San Francisco, and I got about 25 minutes.
I like everything about this machine, especially compared to the Yoga 3 Pro, right? The Yoga 3 Pro was like a step backwards compared to the Yoga 2 Pro, where they went with a lower power processor, so you got lower performance, but they also made it thinner and lighter with smaller batteries, so you actually got less battery life as well. This, they kind of said, okay, turns out people didn't really want that, so they made it a little bit thicker, a little bit heavier, put enough battery in there, and went back to a full 15-watt Core i7 Skylake processor, so you get performance boost. You get fantastic battery life. My battery life test was at the 9-hour mark, which is really, really good for a machine with no external battery attached to it. The screen looks great. It's 3200 by 1800. You know what? We were talking about this last night on our podcast as well, where I really do wish they had offered a 1080p variant of this screen, because you would save tremendously on your power draw. If you remember back to the XPS 13, where they had a 1080p variant and then a higher res variant as well, like there was a 2-hour battery life difference in those just in Wi-Fi, like browsing testing. And that's a lot to have to deal with. And so I don't know what the difference would be, but I assume there would be some amount of difference. So I wish there had been another option for that. But it does look awesome. I don't know, when you got your hands on with it, what they had the scaling set at. When I took mine out of the box, scaling was set to 250%, which essentially makes this a 720p screen, I think, like in terms of screen real estate. So I scaled that back to 200, which made it 1600 by 900 effective resolution. But you had, you know, 4 pixels for every pixel that you're looking at there, and it seems to be a perfect balance. I mean, it's got all the Yoga stuff, right? You can fold it all the way over. You can use it in tent mode. You can use it in tablet mode. I haven't spent enough time with it to decide if I liked the keyboard, and that's the part that I'm glad to hear that you say you liked it, because that gives me hope for it. Because I've been spending my time with the Surface Pro 4, the Surface Book, trying to get through those before I dive into this one. But first impressions of it are really good. And it's pretty cheap, too. It's not cheap, but $1,099 is where it starts at. And that gets you 8 gigs of RAM and a 256-gig SSD. And the highest configuration you get is $1,299. And that's double your memory to 16 gigs and double your SSD to 512. So you get a 16-gig memory, 512-gig NVMe SSD, with 3200 by 1800 resolution screen with tremendous battery life and a Core i7 variant of the 15-watt Skylake processor for $1,299. I think that's a pretty good deal, all things considered. You know, if you look at where the Surface Book is and the Surface Pro 4, they're way more than that to kind of get 512 storage and 16 gigs of RAM.
No, I was actually talking about that on Tech Thing, because the Surface Pro, which I really like now that I've gotten to use it, but the idea that there's like a cheap Surface Pro is kind of inaccurate, because the most affordable Surface Pro 4 is 4 gigabytes of RAM and a Core M processor. And I don't want to run Windows on 4 gigabytes of RAM. It's just unpleasant. At least if you have the option of running 8 gigabytes, and if you run, if you run a single application like you're on a tablet, go with 4 gigabytes of RAM and stay away from video and photo editing. But for everybody else, you want at least 8 gigabytes of RAM. But, it was one of those moments, because I was pricing things out and I was like, Microsoft's obviously making money here, because you're looking at roughly 2x cost for memory or SSD compared to the market value of a similar part. Obviously, you're not going to solder the stuff you bought on Amazon down to their motherboard, but that's one of the things we pointed out. It was very affordable, for a flagship model. And the affordable version wasn't something that you would buy and go like, I can't really use this for anything. There's something wrong about spending $800 and getting like really great specs from 3 years ago. In a fantastic package, but in terms of core processing and stuff, I don't know. It's curious to watch. It's been curious to watch laptop pricing, because there's stuff like, I just got in for review on Tech Thing a $799 gaming laptop with a discrete GPU. What's that?
I think I know who it's from because I got one in today too.
Yeah, and I'm looking at this and I'm like, wow. I mean, it's a 15-inch laptop, so it feels like a dinner plate, but right. It's a dinner plate that, you know, I can expand the memory on. You know, it's a dinner plate that I can, you know, swap out drives if I want to. It's a dinner plate with decent, discreet graphics for gaming.
Yep.
So I'm really curious what the battery life is going to be like. I'll ask you about the battery life.
I just got it in today. I don't know yet. if we're talking about the same Dell machine, then yes.
I'm sure we are. There can't be that many. It's there's 8 gigabytes of RAM for $799. It's good. It's up for sale right now. So we'll apparently PC Per and Tech Thing will have more on that later. but you know, it's a point like, okay, maybe I don't want to carry around a 15-inch, you know, oh, and it's got a full keyboard. Which I have a friend of mine who's an accountant who will weep because he's been dreaming of the days when he would someday again be able to buy a gigantic keyboard built into his laptop. But it's literally, you know, it's set up for gaming. And it's interesting to realize that, you know, what the margin is on product and where the money's going, right? Mm-hmm. You know, it's the Surface Pro 4 it weighs basically nothing. For the kind of computing power you get. Yep. The Yoga weighs a little bit more, but it costs considerably less, and for the money is a little bit better outfitted. I don't know. I'm curious to find how people price things.
Yeah, I think if I were to guess, Microsoft has a higher margin on theirs on purpose.
Right.
You know, they ruffled a lot of feathers coming out the Surface to begin with. So it wouldn't surprise me at all if they were like, okay, you know what, we'll make it up to you. We will charge more for our device than we really would otherwise to make sure that there's room for their partners to come in and sell devices like the Yoga 900 or the XPS 13 and 15.
Right.
If I had to guess, that would be the case. Like, hey, look, we're not in the hardware division to make a whole bunch of money. We want to push people to make better designs with our software. And right. That's kind of their avenue to do so.
Make more better stuff or we'll outsell you.
Well put. Well put.
Kind of a frightening thought. Yeah. We should take a moment to actually give a shout out to our sponsor, Ring. You got one for review, then you bought one out of pocket because you actually found the Ring Video Doorbell to be incredibly useful. Why is that, Mr. Schrapp?
So it's... the idea of the Ring Video Doorbell is pretty straightforward, right? It is a replacement for your standard old doorbell that's been around since the 1800s. I don't know if that's true. Where it is now internet connected. It has a camera on it. It has a motion sensor on it. And it connects to your phone through the Ring Video Doorbell app so that you can answer the door, whether you're home or not, through that device. You can see the camera. It has a microphone on it for you to communicate with the person there. Just today... I was at home with my daughter waiting for the babysitter to show up, and FedEx came to the door at the office, hit the doorbell. Looks kind of, it doesn't look like a normal doorbell, but it looks like a button that should be pushed. He hit it. I got a notification on my phone that there's someone at your door at the office. I answered it. I said, hey, Chris, you know, I'll be there in like 40 minutes. Yeah, go ahead and leave that laptop upstairs with the insurance guys. I'll be in there to pick it up in a bit, right? And we had that conversation, and I didn't have to leave the couch, and I didn't have to worry about missing the delivery. Right. In case it was something that was really important that I get that day. And that's one of the side benefits that you have. The other one is like security, right? So break-ins, 95% of break-ins happen during the day. They almost always start with the burglar ringing the doorbell to see if someone's home before taking all your crap. With the Ring Video Doorbell, you can see and talk to anybody at your door from anywhere in the world using your smartphone. It also has the motion detector that I mentioned. If someone comes to your door, you'll receive an alert on your smartphone, even if they don't actually ring the doorbell, which is pretty nice. And installing Ring takes really just minutes, and it comes with everything you need, including a drill bit and a level so that it looks good when you're doing it. And that's pretty nice too. Can connect to your existing doorbell wiring, or it runs off of built-in rechargeable battery, which is what mine runs off of. And the battery life has been tremendous. I have still yet to actually recharge it at the office. And Time Magazine named it one of the top 10 gadgets of 2014. So you can prevent burglaries before they happen or answer the door for deliveries if you're not home. Go to ring.com/twitch. That's T-W-I-C-H. ring.com/twitch. You can get free FedEx shipping. And with Ring, you are always home. Again, the URL, ring.com/twitch. And we thank them for their support of This Week in Computer Hardware.
Woohoo! We love the support. iPad Pro shipping We got a really good set of photos from the iFixit teardown. It's an interesting product. In part, like my friend Norm over at Tested.com is carrying one right now. And one of the things we were talking about earlier this week was how bizarre the reviews have been for the iPad Pro, because there's a small list of select reviewers that get the earliest Apple products, and they usually write about them in the most glowing terms. Anytime you describe what's basically a bundle of chips, and a screen, you know, as an ephemeral device that elevates the soul in its use, it's like, you know, they got a lot of love there. Don't get me wrong, I talk about headphones as delivering an ephemeral experience, so I'm not immune to that. But the interesting thing about the Pro is, in so many ways, it seems to be a product that is in search of an audience and a very radical, different sort of spin on tablets for Apple. The things that will probably make it most useful, because one person said, and I apologize for not having the quote, I could probably find it. Essentially, it was the first tablet from Apple that was designed to be used on a desktop, except that they aren't shipping the Pencil yet, and they aren't shipping the keyboard yet. And it's really going to be interesting, because it's essentially, you know, it's a Surface competitor. It's a Yoga competitor, except that instead of running an x86 processor, it's running an A9 processor, which is extremely fast in single core processing, especially if you compare it to something like a Core M. But is, you know, it's really the first genuine experiment with, like, kind of, you know, splitting screen and multitasking, which I think it desperately needs to succeed as a professional tool. It's not cheap by any stretch of the imagination. The screen looks good. It feels good in the hand. I mean, you know, it's an Apple iPad. I got a chance to get hands-on with one this morning, but so much of it will make it very distinctive as a tool for creating content rather than just consuming it has yet to be delivered. The software support's kind of erratic in terms of taking advantage of the new features, which is not unexpected. I will be very curious to see where Apple is with this product in a year and what the adoption's been like. I think it was Walt Mossberg who said graphics people will love this. People who spend a lot of time typing, maybe not so much. That's my inflection on the typing, Mr. Mossberg's inflection on people who work with graphics. I think it's going to be interesting to see what artists do with the Pencil. I think it's going to be very interesting to see what comes out there. But just wanted to mention that.
Did they relent and include a cable to charge the Pencil as opposed to still making you plug it into the bottom of your iPad Pro?
I don't know off the top of my head, but in part, I think, because the Pencils haven't shipped yet.
Oh, really? Oh.
That's my – well, let me check. My understanding is that the Pencils are not available to the general public yet. Huh, but with a quick look at the Apple Store, I will have a definitive answer for you, sir. iPad Pro, man. Thin, light, epic. We're going to click on buy. This is the kind of television you can't buy in stores, people. It's only available at twit.tv. Let's scroll down. Let's go with gold because I'm ostentatious. 128 gigabyte Wi-Fi and cellular. That's up to $1,100. What's in the box? Lightning to USB. Oh, Apple accessories made just for iPad Pro. The Logitech keyboard is available for sale.
I saw that one.
Apple Pencil for iPad Pro will be available in 4 to 5 weeks. So the answer is I doubt it, but we'll know for a fact in about a month. And I'm seeing, yeah, what's in the box? Apple Pencil, Lightning adapter, extra tip.
All right.
Sorry, dude.
All right.
Dream on with your convenience and simplicity. Just not the way it's going to be done, sir. AMD Radeon R9 380X coming November 15th for $249. It is a great time to be a 1080p gamer. My beloved 750 Ti has been pushed down the hill by the 950. The original, the AMD parts for 40 or 50 bucks more, delivering 15-20% more performance. Where's the 380X going to fit in the lineup at this point?
You know, I honestly don't even really know the answer to this. So
it's like
what's interesting about it?
Slightly faster.
Yeah, it's going to be between a 380 and a 390. How's that?
Right.
There's a significant price gap between those.
Right.
So there's definitely a spot for it. It seems late to the game to be releasing a product at this point, based on a GPU that we've all seen for a long time, right? This is essentially based on the rumors. If it's codename Antigua, it's basically a Tonga GPU with slightly increased specs. It would be the first Tonga GPU that actually has 2048 stream processors. You know, the clock speeds are in range with what we have seen all AMD GPUs to be at recently. 4 gigs of memory is nice. 256-bit memory bus would be bigger than the one that exists on Tonga-based GPUs today. Memory clock about the same. Display output about the same. I mean, it fills a gap that exists in AMD's market. But I don't know. Like I said, it feels late. It feels like...
Right. Hey, look, we're bin sorting parts, and we might be able to get enough of these to fill something in between the 380 and the 390. We can charge more. Maybe that'll force NVIDIA to drop their prices more.
Yeah, like everybody, what everybody wants and expects is, like, new GPUs from both these guys now.
Right.
More so from AMD than from NVIDIA, because we've had Maxwell, right, since. And Fiji is new, but only at the very, very, very top end of their product stack. So, I don't know. I'm hopeful that it turns out to be just a wildly great performer at a significant price point, like a significantly impressive price point, I guess. But we'll just have to see. They says November 15th, which is only 3 days away. That's probably wrong on the date, would be my guess. Unless they're just not going to send me one. I don't know. It's possible. Who knows?
It is possible.
It is.
But, you know, there's a strong there, I think, and this may be rude of me to say, there's a strong correlation between them hitting that deadline and not seating vendors, the reviewers, and it not being a spectacular performer for the money. That may be my inner cynic. You know, I prefer to be more generous and think that you just piss them off for some reason. And
I mean, that's possible too.
For the moment.
Yeah.
But I think that was, you know, a year or two ago when you were in that phase.
Oh yeah, no, yeah, we're way better now. They used to hate me, but we're much better now.
You guys go way back, man.
Oh, way back.
NVIDIA confirms clock speed, power increases, and high refresh rates, promises fix. If you've been following along at PCPro.com or right here on This Week in Computer Hardware, you know that NVIDIA's GeForce GTX graphics cards. You know, specifically, I guess this came out of the testing of the Asus ROG Swift PG279Q with its massive 165 hertz rate. But you notice that green line there above the blue line, if you're watching at home with video, is that far spike on the end is 201 watts, which is considerably higher than, you know, the parts running at like 76 watts through 76 watts. Right up through 120 hertz, and then bumps up to 133 watts and 144 megahertz refresh rates. And then, wham, 201 watts at 165 hertz refresh rates. Certainly a surprise for Ryan. and NVIDIA basically says, you were right. The new monitor or you exposed a bug in the way our GPU is managing clocks for G-Sync and very high refresh rates. As a result of your findings, Ryan Shrout, we at NVIDIA are fixing the bug, which will lower the operating point of our GPUs back to the same power level for other displays. We'll have this fixed in an incoming driver. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a case of in-depth analysis yielding a better product for us all. And I, for one, salute you, Mr. Shrout. Also, NVIDIA props for saying, like, oh, wow, that's right. Let's fix that.
I appreciate the gesture. It's and like a commenter pointed it out to me. Like, I didn't notice it. And I remember reading the comment and thinking, oh, that's probably not right. And then testing and go, wow, that was surprising. And to be fair, to be completely honest about it, like, this is, people have been talking about this type of stuff in forums for apparently a while, that it existed in other displays. Sometimes the benefit of being in the position that we are in is, like, you can affect change, right? You can cause something to happen. And it was like, okay, call them up on the phone and be like, look, what is going on here? And they're like, oh, let us look into it some more. And then 48 hours later, you get, like, a positive response like that. So I don't have the driver yet. I can't validate that they've actually fixed it. If they're coming out with that statement, I have to assume that they know how they're going to fix it. They just haven't implemented it yet. So as soon as I get a hold of the driver, we'll go through and validate everything, test it all out, and make sure that we are seeing the improvements that we should see going back to kind of what you expect idle power consumption to actually be at. So hopefully that'll work.
Basically, the thing does the thing, so it's able to do the thing without blowing out the thing.
Exactly, yeah. All of those words.
I don't want to get technical on you, Ryan.
Yeah, yeah. You want the things to run at the correct speed so they're not using more things that come from the wall just to sit there and show you windows.
If you're right on the edge in terms of your power supply's, you know, watts rating, and all of a sudden your GPU effectively doubles the amount of wattage it's consuming.
Yeah.
You know, I think it's difficult to call that a feature, but a bug certainly works.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. Hey, this episode of This Week in Computer Hardware is also brought to you by Ting.com. Ting, you should know about Ting. If you like saving money, you should really know about Ting. They're a U.S. mobile service. They started out on Sprint as a reseller, Sprint CDMA. They are now on Sprint and T-Mobile GSM. They don't believe in contracts. They don't believe in overage fees. They don't believe in unlimited plans, which is really cool. You know, they got two nationwide networks. The pricing's really amazing. They have a calculator on the Ting website, and you're like, oh, it's, you know, me and the kids send this many texts, we download this much data, and I use this many minutes, and this is what I'm paying now. And your usual reaction at this point is, holy cow, I can save a lot of money. If you're stuck in a if you're staring at that and thinking, like, I really want to move to Ting because my children's text habits won't bankrupt me on my aging contract. You know, if you're stuck in that contract, Ting will give you a credit if you're, you know, paying an ETF to come to Ting. 25% credit, up to $75 per device for coming to Ting. Go to ting.com/ETF, early termination fee, ETF, for more information on that. Ting's started small and has been getting bigger and bigger. Their tech support's fantastic. 80% of devices can come to Ting. And they have a device checker up at ting.com/BYOD. It's really easy for you to see if your device can make the move to Ting. The control panels, it's funny. Like I've spent a lot of time with a couple different networks, and it's hard to tell if they just never finish the website or if they just want to sort of obfuscate as much data as possible to make it as difficult as possible for you to make intelligent buying decisions. Ting lays it all out front. Their account control panel is fantastic. You get your usage, your bills, your device information. It's really simple. It's organized like somebody that doesn't hate their customers would organize a website. And if you're looking for upgrade, Ting has plenty of options in their online shop. It's really simple. Once you have the device you want to use with Ting, Ting walks you through getting started, including bringing over, or we also like to call it porting your existing number or getting a brand new one. Ting, if you're paying too much for your cell phone, or if you think you might possibly be paying too much for your cell phone bill, your mobile bill for you or your family, do yourself a favor. Go to twitch.ting.com. That's twich.ting.com. And you're going to save money. You probably better manage your cell phone usage. You get $25 off select devices or mobile phone service just for getting started, but only if you go to twitch.ting.com. We want to thank them for their support of This Week in Computer Hardware. Thank you, Ting. Make Indeed. A good product. They do, they do. Haven't been a lot of news in the watch world in a lot of ways for the last couple months. At least it feels like, or maybe we're missing some of the smaller devices because we're getting to that point where it's kind of like Bluetooth speakers where the creation of this new product category is, you know, gone from 3 or 4 leaders to, you know, a dozen names you're familiar with to thousands of manufacturers doing short contract runs at Shenzhen manufacturing facilities. But it's pretty interesting this week because two things happened. The announcements was that cellular support has now come to Android Wear. So, you know, normally it's like, okay, you know, I got Bluetooth, I got Wi-Fi on Android Wear. But now they're actually bringing cellular support into Android Wear. So you no longer have to be in range of your phone or the Wi-Fi. You'll still be able to do things like run your favorite apps, get messages, track your fitness. The first Android Wear watch with cellular support, says the Android official blog, is the LG Watch Urbane 2nd Edition LTE. So it's interesting to watch these kind of scale. I'll be very curious to see what the battery life is on that and how they manage the consumption. Because certainly Bluetooth 4.0 is a little thriftier with the power consumption than Definitely. Any kind of you know, device that connects to the phones. The other big one for me, at least, because I was watching, I was kind of curious what was going to happen with some of the major watch manufacturers. And Tag Heuer, which hopefully I'm saying properly, and if not, I'm sure I'll get mocked by the watch enthusiasts in the audience, has delivered the Tag Heuer Connected, which is their Android Wear watch. And it's a pretty nice looking piece of watch. You know, if you're into the big, I am a 1950s diver, a 1960s pilot. You know, it's funny because there's like the big plastic band, but, you know, it's a classic Tag watch. It's a big watch with a big knob on the side. You know, it's a very butch kind of design there. Sapphire crystal, LTPS LCD display. It's like 360 by 360, 240 PPI display on that. You know, IP67 splash proof, so it's maybe not as bomb proof as some of the other waters, some of the other watches from there. But it's a good looking watch. And one of the things that's interesting is if you decide this $1,500 or $1,200 watch, let me double check that price on there. Yeah, it's going to be around $1,500 unless you can find a discount on that. If you don't like it, you can actually trade that in as a credit towards a more expensive Tag watch, which having a couple friends that already have a couple of early smartwatches that have been retired now have a street value of approximately nothing. Tags obviously wants to keep their enthusiastic brand fans, audience, right, whatever we call the people that love wearing big cool guy watches.
I have a Tag watch, not one of the smartwatches, obviously, that I got as a wedding gift for my wife, and I love it, and I still wear it when we go out to fancy places and stuff like that. I don't consider myself a watch enthusiast by any stretch because I only have that one really nice, fancy, expensive watch, but for some reason, I think paying $3,000 for an expensive piece of jewelry, which is a watch essentially, right, makes more sense than paying $1,500 for an electronic piece of jewelry like the smartwatch that will fundamentally be improved upon in 12 months.
Profoundly improved upon. Well, at least it's not as staggeringly brutal as the $10,000 Apple Watch.
Right. That's just crazy nuts. Yeah.
Well, I mean, if you're buying that, it just means you have more money than you need, right? Which is correct. Fair. That's what capitalism is all about. But
yeah, that's.
But I just thought it was interesting that they're at least like, hey, you know what? If you decide within X number of years that this was not your wisest watch purchasing choice, it will give you the retail value towards something nicer.
I think it say that they'll give it towards a non-smartwatch, right?
That is
like
my understanding.
Like a regular watch, right? So you can't use it to upgrade to the next Tag Android Wear watch in a year or two. It's to, hey, if you want to buy one of our $5,000 watches, we'll let you do that,
well,
right?
You know.
I'm sure there are people that will do it, but I don't understand, like, if you want a smartwatch, if you're the person that uses a smartwatch, why you would want to upgrade to a non-smartwatch?
I think what they are assuming is that Tag Heuer enthusiasts who have multiple watches manufactured by Tag will consider taking a risk on this if it turns out to be an excuse to buy an expensive watch they weren't going to buy otherwise.
Yeah.
If this whole Android Wear connectivity thing doesn't work out the way they hoped it did. You know, there's a certain logic there for me because I think, you know, yeah. I think they're basically developing a watch not to bring more people into the Tag brand, although I'm sure they'd love that, but they're basically offering something for people who probably already own two or three or four Tag watches. Probably am spectacularly wrong, but I don't get a lot of the insights of the marketing wheres and whys of you know, ancient.
I think it looks better than any other smartwatch that I have seen. Right, it looks more like a normal watch, which is something that appeals to me. Right. I just got in
normal watch.
So
my old
because
Timex
you went to IDF, I got in. I got the Basis Peak in. Mm-hmm. This is the one that they gave to everybody who attended IDF in August, I guess, and it just arrived. And it doesn't look anything like a normal watch, right? It looks like a smartwatch, and it's got an electronic ink screen and all that stuff. But I'll try it, right? That's what I do. But I would love to have one that kind of looked and felt more like the tag, but it wasn't $1,500 as well. So I don't know. There will be more options coming. It will not be. It's not a trend. It's not a trend, I guess I should say, that's going to like wither and die, clearly. Yeah. It's something that is going to be around for a while. I find it to be incredibly useful. We just need to perfect it.
Yes.
It's not like Google Glass, where it's like, well, that was dumb.
I don't know if it was dumb. I think it got beaten to death in public before it could be realized.
Yeah.
I think some variation on Google Glass will be back from somewhere.
Yeah.
But I might just be an optimist. Oh, my goodness. Asus ROG Maximus 8 Extreme Assembly. Sorry, I just get really excited about that.
Yeah, I understand.
Actually, it's funny. I have the Maximus 8 Impact, which I'm very excited about because it's a mini ITX version.
Ooh.
Of the Maximus 8. Yeah, it's so tiny. And I was so glad that you did that roundup of mini ITX cases because now I'm like, oh, it's so tiny. I want that one. And a 90-degree riser for my GPU and ponies. Lots and lots of ponies. Sebastian wrote this up for PC Per. Basically, it's an addition to the Republic of Gamers lineup, the Matrix GTX 980 Ti. And the Maximus 8 Extreme / Assembly, which is a Z170 board with an external headphone amp and 10 gigabit per second Ethernet add-in card included in the box. I thought that's pretty fantastic. Not that I'm going to need a 10 gigabyte Ethernet card anytime soon.
Don't you want it? Like,
hell yes, I do.
We talked about it last night. It was like, I remember the first time I saw a gigabit Ethernet on a motherboard. I remember thinking how stupid it was. Like, oh, no, my God.
That's because you weren't producing video at the time.
Well, yeah, you're right. You're 100% correct. And I was like, man, nobody's, like, everybody's home network is 10-100. Nobody's using this. Like, you know, what is the purpose of this? And now I'm sitting there and I see this release and I go, man, that would be really useful to move all of that video data from that machine to that machine. I want to buy two of those 10 gigi cards and just, like, patch cable between them or something, right? Like I immediately see the benefits of it. And now that my internet here at the office is gigabit speed, it's like you want to have a global network, like an intra machine network that is faster than your external connection, just so you are prepared for everything else going forward in the future, I think. I don't know. The motherboard's going to be like $800 or something. Because what else does it come with? It comes with something besides a 10 gigi card.
An external headphone amplifier.
Yeah.
I mean, it's funny, like, you know, 10 gig cards sell for a couple hundred bucks right now.
Yep.
Oh, excuse me, 240, according to link Sebastian put in there. So they're even more expensive than I thought they were. An external headphone amp, you know, they've got a Saber ESS DAC, digital analog converter, down on the motherboard, which is pretty fantastic. You know, it's a pretty amazing collection of hardware. And you're going to, you know, pay pretty amazing collections of hardware prices for it, which is probably reasonable or unreasonable, but I don't know. You're getting a lot for your money if you want all of those things.
True.
Yeah. Which is like compared to the $240 street price for the Maximus 8 Impact. Let's see, 1151. Let me not get distracted because it's entirely too easy.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's so many motherboards, so much awesome to be found. What's going on with Logic Supply's fanless Perfectron? Because it seems like we keep coming up with, well, this isn't really an unusual cooling solution. I mean, are they liquid cooling an entire PC inside of that box?
I don't even know if it's liquid cooled. I think it's just like
a giant
all
heat sink?
Passively cooled. Yeah, I don't know if it's, is it liquid? I don't think it is. I don't think it's, let's see. No, I don't think it's water cooled. So it's like a $6,000 computer that looks like that. It doesn't look like a computer at all. But it's capable of running at ambient temperatures of 70 degrees Celsius, a.k.a. 158 degrees Fahrenheit.
Right.
And that's just nuts. Yeah. And it's a Core i7 processor. You can get a discrete GPU in it. It's got USB 3. Like, it's pretty impressive what all you can put in there. this is not for consumers, obviously, very specific use cases where you're worried about ambient temperatures of 160 degrees Fahrenheit.
Yeah. Well, it's basically engineered, you know, for a mil-spec standard, like 810G, which I don't think I've ever even heard of before. Environmental engineering considerations and laboratory tests. That's just designed to just do horrible things, right? Because these are industrial machines. These are not something, like Brian said, you would normally buy for your house. You know, but the 810, you know, yeah, negative 40 degrees Celsius to 70 degrees Celsius operating temperature. That is a lot. That's just a huge thermal range to deal with. I mean, this would be like, you know, something that would get stuffed in between the skin and the cockpit of an aircraft or in a tank or some horrible thing like that.
Right.
Yeah. Yes. 158
It's neat. Obviously it's not useful for any purpose that I particularly have. I hope I never am working in an environment where I need a computer capable of that.
158 degrees is incredibly uncomfortable.
Yes. Yes. Indeed it is.
Yeah.
Oh, well.
Yeah. So if you're looking for the completely unhinged ultimate, I take it back. They got prices on them now. Usually ships in 5 to 7 weeks. Intel Haswell i7 processor, starting at $6,229. Intel Haswell i7 processing and NVIDIA GPU starting at $9,286.
Yeah.
And if you want the ultra rugged IP65 fanless i7 computer with M12 connectors, which has a 40 to 75 degrees Celsius operating temperature, you're looking at $13,793.
So, sure. Yeah. Okay. What's wrong with that? I got nothing.
Well, if you're talking about if your computer dies, people start dying left and right, or the plane runs into a hill, or the boat runs into a tree or something.
Yeah.
You know, it may seem relatively cheap compared to the expensive thing it goes inside of. I'm just thinking.
Yep.
I'm just thinking there.
Agreed.
Hey, we want to welcome back Drobo to the network. They are a sponsor of this week in computer hardware. I've been playing around with one of the Drobos here at work, which has been fun. They sent it out for use. There's something nice about having a whole bunch of drives in a box connected to your computer over a fast USB 3.0 connection. It's got, you know, the nice thing about it is still the thing that's always been awesome about the Drobos from the very early days is the configuration is staggeringly simple. I like simple when it comes to my storage. I like it to work. You know, Drobo is about making it easy to set up and streamline your home media server, your small business server, your big business server. They have an incredible array of products that are available. It's easy to use. You know, if you're looking at the 5N, just plug it into your switch, your router, you're ready to go. It'll work as a media server, a file server, to back up. It works with Plex. It's great if you need something to basically add to storage for your Kodi or your XBMC setups. The 5N's got a quad-core ARM processor, so it can run BitTorrent or other tools for gathering files across the internet without sucking down clock cycles from your PC. It doesn't matter if you're using a Nook or a media PC at the front end. Drobo is a great network solution to replace all of your various external hard drives. And if you are still running around with a whole bunch of hard drives attached to a bunch of different devices, it's time for you to get the information in one place, you know, where it's backed up. In a way that if you lose a drive, you don't lose all of your data. It's really, you know, it's cool, right? Data received by a Drobo, now you're written to disk, is protected in case there's a sudden power loss, which I have actually tested with the Drobo 5D because I'm an idiot. You know, it's got two Thunderbolt connections, one USB 3.0 connection, and I just started kind of ripping the power cord out occasionally because I stress test things. It's what I do. Ryan is a systematic, incredibly organized human being who develops new benchmarking standards to accurately assess things. And I rip power cables out of things while they're doing important things with the data I don't want to lose. So your data remains safe. Drobo makes it really easy to upgrade your system because you can basically pull a drive, replace a drive. It's all toolless enclosure. Beyond RAID technology lets you expand on the fly, mix and match drives. I've got a 2, 3, and 4 terabyte drive inside of there now, and I'm going to throw a couple more in there. It's simple. If you can read colors, you can basically tell whether your Drobo is happy. You know, they support Thunderbolt, Gigabit, USB 3.0 to stream your HD enlarged media files or to back up your system or to move huge files into storage quickly and efficiently. I like it. It's a good tool. Visit Drobo.com/twit to learn more and check out their complete line of products. And when you use the code TWIT100, that is TWIT100, you'll save $100 off the purchase of a Drobo Mini, Drobo 4-Bay, or Drobo 5N. It's a good deal, folks. Drobo.com/twit. Use the code TWIT, TWIT100. We want to thank Drobo for their support of this week in computer hardware.
Indeed.
Oh, my goodness. Asus lights up budget Skylake with new B150 Pro Gaming D3 motherboard. I was already so excited about the fact that compared to, like, the X99 motherboards, Skylake came out with really nice, well-equipped motherboards starting about $125, $140. Tim Vary wrote this up for PC Per. Asus B150 Pro Gaming D3, a cheaper alternative that sacrifices some expandability while still incorporating several enthusiast-friendly features. And I should say it's not a Z170. The B150 is an alternative to the Z170 that basically nobody has written about because there's been so many amazing Z170 motherboards. LG 1151 socket ready for Core i7 Skylake processors, powered by the company's DigiPlus VRMs. 4 DDR3 slots. Interesting. If you're looking for something to kind of bridge, you know, if you have a whole bunch of DDR3, this could be the motherboard for you. Supporting up to 64 gigabyte dual channel DDR3 modules at 1,866 megahertz. Pretty much all Skylake motherboards have been DDR4. 6 SATA 6 gigabit per second ports, a single M.2 slot for solid state drives. It's only going to do 2 lanes of PCI Express. So it's not going to be as ASCII as the quad PCI Express. The motherboards that support the quad PCI for the M.2 sticks. The Supreme FX audio hardware from Asus, single PCIe 3.0 by 16 slot, and the board further includes a second PCIe 3.0 x16 slot, 2 PCIe x1 slots, and 2 PCI slots for legacy expansion cards. If you have a bunch of stuff you want to keep running or you just want to save as much money on a build, this has a lot of potential. 2 PS2 ports, HDMI, VGA, 4 USB 3.0, 1 USB 3.1 Type A, 1 USB 3.1 Type C, Gigabit Ethernet on board, you know, an analog audio, you know, basically 5 analog audio ports with pretty badass. They're claiming the amp will support 300 ohm headphones, so the amp's got some oomph. Mm. A SPDIF connector. One of the things that Tim notes that the major downgrade from Z170 to B150 is the number of PCI Express lanes. Z170 has 20, B150 has 8. So if you use the second physical X16 slot with a x4 or faster device, the 2 physical X1 slots will be disabled. So basically, if you want to run dual GPUs, you're not going to be using those X1 slots. And if you use the M.2 slot for your SSD in SATA mode, one of the physical SATA ports will be disabled. Because they have a relatively finite amount of bandwidth. Pricing has not been available, but I feel comfortable in saying that this is probably going to be in the $100 range, maybe less. Am I high? Or does that feel like?
No, I think $100 is probably right in line with where I would expect this to be as well. And that's why I wanted to add it in here. It was like, okay, we can get even cheaper Skylake systems. I actually just got in... a Core i3 6100, which is a 2-core, 4-thread Skylake processor. That was $120.
Wow.
It's the first time I'd seen it. I saw it on Newegg, just ordered one in. And so I'm trying to get one of these B150 motherboards. So I say, okay, now you've got a, and I think that motherboard uses DDR3 memory instead of DDR4. So you can save money there. Like in terms of getting a budget Skylake build ready for Christmas, I think this might be, like your best option,
right?
By a long shot, actually.
Well, is it going to ship in time? I think is the big question.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, I don't know. I've contacted Asus, and I think MSI has one as well, like a B150 board that is you know, competent in features, got USB 3.1, got, you know, M.2 support. Like, you're not missing a whole bunch of stuff. Like, if you're just building a right. machine for gaming, I think it'd be interesting build, to say the least. At least that's the goal when I bought that processor, is that hopefully this will be like, hey, you don't need to, if you don't want to, you don't have to spend X amount of dollars to build a decent machine these days. Like, you're always looking for what the new best budget configuration is.
Right.
So we'll see. Could be.
Me. Yeah. Yeah. No, I'm about to replace my beloved sub $400 gaming PC, that I've been using as a desktop for most of the last year with a Core i5 system. And, it'll be amazing to see what $400 can purchase, by January when we're all poor again after Christmas. NovaChips SSD comes in 4 terabyte and 8 terabytes. And if you're sitting there at home thinking, who? You're not alone. Not a lot of people are familiar with this brand. There's a really good write-up on the SSD review. Alan did a quick summary up on PCPer.com. So, quote, two things still create a bottleneck in SSD capacity. I'm quoting Les Tokar off of the SSD review. These being the mechanics of today's SSDs along with flash pricing. NovaChips hopes to tackle this with the introduction of their Scalar family of 4 and 8 terabyte notebook size SSDs, now available to OEM, enterprise, and even the consumer. They're 2.5 inch SSDs, the 4 terabyte 7 millimeter, the 8 terabyte 15 millimeters. So that's obviously not going to fit in the vast majority of laptops. 6 gigabit per second, SATA 3 bandwidth, pretty much possibly, I would assume, saturating it. It is a huge write-up. Les founded the SSD review, and he gets pretty deep in taking a look at these. And because I'm cruel and unusual, I'm going to make you go to the SSDreview.com to find out how he felt about it and if it got an editor's choice or not. So I like to drive traffic to people. It makes me feel better.
Yep.
But I was surprised. It's a really interesting part, and it's 8 terabytes, and it's not nearly going to be as expensive as the 16 terabyte drive we were talking about earlier this year from Samsung.
That's also true. Still very expensive.
Well, but not life as itself expensive. Is very expensive.
I find that to be the case every day. Yes,
and your definitely. And your kid hasn't even gotten problematic yet.
I know. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Enjoy your toys. Now, buy all the toys now, man. Wait till you find out what preschools cost, even in Kentucky.
I know.
At Stankhauser, which I'm probably butchering because my German is atrocious, says at Patrick North, at Ryan Trout, why is the Apple TV 4 so half-baked? Cruel, but fair. First of all, it's enormously difficult to do a major development on an existing platform and have your vendors be up to speed, or I should say your developers, your developer community. You know, there's a reason when somebody comes out with a new operating system or a new platform, you know, that you often find they cherry pick and pay a lot of money to a couple of high profile developers to have their game or their app or whatever that particular thing is ported to this new platform. You know, and if you think the Apple TV 4 is half baked, you should have seen the first generation Blu-ray players or some of the early early console game experiences, you know, when Sony and Xbox decided to jump into Nintendo land or Sony and Microsoft. But, you know, it's an unfinished and evolving product. You know, the remote control is not my favorite. I'm going to flat out say, I mean, as the I just put that a couple things about the Apple TV remote are absolutely fantastic. You know, but a lot of what's going on with the Apple TV is trying to radically change the Apple TV and bring it into kind of the same world that the iPad and the iPhone exist in, which is obviously running applications. And that makes it a much more interesting platform for continuing to develop. I mean, it's curious, right? Because when you fire up the Apple TV and you sign in, some of your existing applications that are available in tvOS versions will be free, and other ones are going to cost you money. Because it costs money to develop applications and try to make them fit in a new environment. You know, the menu button, the home button is like practically worth the price of the upgrade alone. If you go nuts trying to get back out of Netflix and going through 22 layers of menus, the home button and the volume buttons are a great feature. Experiment with the sensitivity settings inside the control panel, the settings for the touchpad that can make it a little bit easier. You know, the typing menu is atrocious. Somebody, I think, chose style over performance, which happens sometimes. Johnny, and I'm not going to give the man much crap, but you know, there's also arguments that say, you know, the Apple Watch didn't need the winding knob on the side, so you know, maybe their ability to edit is a little less awesome than it used to be. You know, performance rise, it's great. My kids are loving the games. Everything works so far. The menuing system, the audio. You know, getting 5.1 to output correctly in the format you want is a little messier than I think it should be. But then again, the Roku 4 shipped with no support for surround sound on a lot of applications. So, you know, it seems like so many products these days are shipped and then they start fixing the problems as fast as they can. You know, I just don't think that's the way things usually feel when they're coming from Apple. You know, or it's such a radically new device that you're, you know, not even noticing it. But it's a you know, it's a funny product, right? Because it's not supporting 4K, which is a big deal for everybody else. And I was like, why aren't they supporting 4K? And I'm like, duh, because they're going to make you buy another one when they decide there's enough 4K content, just like they made you buy another Apple TV, like 2010 to 2012. What was the difference? They went from 720p to 1080p. And fundamentally, other than that, the exact same little black box. So, you know, they're good at making money, and they know there's just not that. They don't have any 4K content in the iTunes store. Most people don't have 4K TVs, so why on earth would they spend the money to do that when they can spend the money to do it later and get everybody who bought one now to buy another one? So, you know, don't even get me started on the Comcast unlimited data plan. we have one last question before we go. Big Ed 1961. I'm just stuck in the living room this week, so we got a couple of living room tech questions, hardware questions. Big Ed 1961 says, at Patrick Norton, at Ryan Schrader, how to get my Beats to connect with my PlayStation 4? And fundamentally, it's a little erratic. Some people have gotten like the Beats Solo to connect to the PlayStation 4. The only people I knew who have been successful in connecting the Beats, there's some YouTube videos on it where they're essentially attaching, they're using the audio jack in the remote. You know, this is, my understanding though, is that it's not supported. You can try your headphones and basically manually go through the settings and try outputting, you know, if you can plug the headphones into the socket on the remote control, try outputting all audio to that to see if it'll pick up. But my understanding, and please, tweet at Patrick Norton, or better yet, tweet at Ryan Schrout.
Wait, what?
I'm torturing you. You know, if you have found a way to get sort of Bluetooth audio support with the Beats headphones, I would be curious to hear about how you manage that, or if it just works now and nobody's been writing about it on the interwebs, which is entirely a possibility. But yeah, yep. It's, you know, you can... You know, one of the things, I mean, you know, it's just a little bit crazy and it's not nearly as simple as it should be, but you know, HDMI out for the audio, you want to send all audio, on the output to headphones on the remote control. And good luck. Cause it's a pretty common, there's a lot of people that own PlayStation 4s and own Beats headphones that are kind of irritated by this. So hopefully that helps you out a little bit. And if not, I am so sorry. Dude, it's interesting. I think it's going to be interesting as we kind of get into the slower part of the year, heading in towards Black Friday, which in terms of new product news tends to be pretty chill before the flurry of pre-CES announcements in December. But if you got a question, if you're shopping for Black Friday and you're looking for a little help, do us a favor, tweet at Ryan Schrout or at Patrick Norton, and we will help you out as best we can on the show next week, or just directly inside Twitter, because we like to help people. We're helpers. So, you know, we're both looking at a $799 gaming laptop that will be reviewed and posted probably on PC Per before it is on Tech Thing, because you can post that whenever you want. I have to wait till Wednesday next week. I've lost my mind with Windows 10 and realized that the refresh and the reset, which is actually really cool. The refresh is a little irritating, but it has saved at least one machine I was running.
Nice.
But sometimes it doesn't show up when you go into the advanced boot menu in Windows 10, which is really emotionally traumatic when you're trying to shoot a video about that. Very confusing. Like, well, did I invent refresh? I could have sworn I did a refresh on the system, but there's only a reset.
Yeah.
But if you want to reinstall Windows 10 and you want to do it in the least traumatic way possible, go check out this week's episode of Tech Thing. PC Purr, I cannot speak about Mr. Malfantano's current whereabouts, except to say that he's going to do something cool, and he's going to be wearing a very funny outfit while he's doing it. Mm-hmm. Anything you can tease about what's coming up on PC Purr?
We've got monitors. We've got lots of monitors in here that need reviews to finish. We have slightly lower cost FreeSync monitors. We have the Acer Predator X34, which is the 34-inch, 3440 by 1440 G-Sync monitor. Wow. That I just got in that needs, I haven't even taken out of the box yet. I feel so bad, but I promised myself I wouldn't until I got through a couple of other stories I needed to get up. Then I still have to finish the written reviews of the Surface Book and Surface Pro 4. So if you're interested in, and start on the Yoga 900 as well. So if you're interested in Skylake laptops and how they all kind of compare to each other, we will have information on that pretty soon.
I really like the Surface Pro 4 a lot more than I expected to.
Yeah. There's a lot of good stuff about it, for sure.
Yes. It's so light. Yeah. It's actually ridiculously light. So, ladies and gentlemen, do us a favor. If you have not checked it out, if you're new to the podcast, head on over to twit.tv/TWICH. twit.tv/TWICH. I will enunciate like I actually studied the language. And you'll find information on how to subscribe to the show, where to find more about what's going on with Ryan and I, and all, of course, the Twit programming is available at twit.tv. And if you're new to it, go check it out. There's some good stuff there.
Indeed.
Ryan Shroud can be found at pcpur.com or at Ryan Shroud. I'm at Patrick Norton, or you can find me at techthing, techthing.com. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to bring this episode of This Week in Computer Hardware to a close. Thank you so much for listening. I'm Patrick Norton.
And I'm Ryan Shroud.
We'll see you next week.